Oh, hello everyone. So we're super excited to have another Jakarta Tech Talk today again. And it is building microservices with Jakarta E and MicroProfile. And today we have the honor of having Edwin Dierks with us. So without further ado, we have already about 20 people waiting to start the session. So I'll hand it over to Edwin and ask him to start his presentation.
Okay, thank you, Tanya.
You're welcome.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining my talk. It is about how to build microservices with Jakarta EE and MicroProfile. As you may or may not know, Jakarta EE is the successor to the already established Java EE framework, and I'm going to tell you not on a more code level, but more on a conceptual level on how to build microservices with Jakarta EE and MicroProfile, and what you can gain from it and benefit from when you start using this framework. Also, to put Jakarta a little bit into context, I do a little bit of comparison to its most similar framework, Spring. But first, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Edwin Dierks. I am employed as a software architect at Ordina JTEC in the Netherlands. I'm a Java developer for more than 12 years now, and I have done several Java enterprise projects, and I still like that. And aside from my daily job, I'm also writing blogs and articles and being a conference speaker. But then, without further ado, let's sail into the talk and start off with a little story about the Netherlands. Like I already said, I'm working in the Netherlands, but I'm also living in the Netherlands, so I'm a Dutch guy. And we have a lot of stereotypical things in the Netherlands, like tulips, but there's one more thing we have a lot of in the Netherlands, and that's bicycles. So many bicycles even, that in certain parts of certain cities, you have to watch out as a pedestrian not to be run over by a swarm of bicyclists. But we don't have just bikes for ourselves, we have bikes for different purposes. And that leads to the very interesting concepts that you see here. We can take goods or kids on our bikes. So if I want to go somewhere and I need to take something with me, I can choose a bike that best fits the purpose and the goal. So this is one of the things in my life that I can choose from with a different purpose. But in my professional career, I also had to make these choices, namely in choosing software frameworks. For some reason, in my experience, I always seem to end up in either Java EE-based or Spring-based projects. And to see from my experience how I got to now Jakarta EE and put Jakarta a little bit into context and where we are now, I will go a little bit over this timeline. So in the late 90s, Java was released, and shortly after that, the first versions of Java EE as an enterprise edition were also released. And even Spring Framework came from that period. But the enterprise framework solves the demands and purposes we have for building enterprise applications, reals that we don't want to reinvent all the time ourselves. So for example, setting up database connections, generating HTML pages, do some messaging, stuff like that. And all these tools together are put into a framework, and then you can benefit from that as a developer. So over the years, not only the Java EE and Spring Framework, of course, matured into providing more features, but also the hardware we were running on also matured. Hardware got faster and cheaper, so this opened new possibilities for building and hosting our services. And even at the end of the first decade of this millennium, the cloud came up, and that opened even more possibilities about scaling and hosting our services. And especially the scaling part was interesting because we now noticed that the frameworks we already had, Java EE and Spring, were not suitable too much for that purpose. So we started to evolve them and even build separate frameworks. And from the Spring community, Spring Boot emerged, a framework that is tailored for running in scalable environments like a cloud. And from the Java EE ecosystem, MicroProfile emerged with the same purpose. And if you skip over the timeline a little bit, a few more years, then we see Jakarta EE emerged. And I will show you and tell you everything about how that looks now. But Jakarta EE is there now for a reason. And this reason, or maybe valid or not, but there are perceptions also over Java EE and Jakarta EE from developers in the community. Because no one can deny that Spring Boot, for example, is a lively framework that's all around on conferences. There are a lot of talks about it. It's all over the picture. And if you look at the Java EE ecosystem, there are not too many talks about Java EE yet. And this has given a perception to some developers that Java EE might not be suitable as a framework nowadays to build enterprise applications with. That the concept of application servers is a old concept that might not be applicable anymore. That you can't build microservices with Java EE, and even the Jakarta EE could be just a rebranding of Java EE. Well, we can argue that there may be some truth to these perceptions, but they're not necessarily true. And that is what I want to elaborate on in this talk, to show you that you can actually build microservices or scalable service in 2019 using Jakarta EE with the help of MicroProfile. And from my experience to compare using Java EE or Spring in my projects, I get this question many times from many different people, but I can't just answer with one of those frameworks. They are so similar, they are so alike, but you can spin up services and applications fast with either framework. And there is a truth for me. I can't just choose one of these frameworks over a project by just seeing how fast I can build a hello world with it. For me, over my years of experience, I noticed that I had a lot more trouble maintaining Spring-based applications than Java EE applications. Over the years, if an application is maintained for a few years, then it is possible that you have several dependencies that need to be upgraded, and some are not. That can give conflicts on the class path sometimes. And because Spring is a component-based framework, you have to maintain all the components that you have defined in your project yourself. And using Java EE by the use of application servers, I noticed that I had put a lot less effort in maintaining these applications because the complexity of all these dependencies was in the application server. So when I built small applications that didn't use too many or even none dependencies themselves that were all in the application server, the maintenance was really low. So that's one of the best and most valuable reasons to choose Java EE over Spring. And another thing is that, of course, Java EE with the specifications and the application servers provide some options for portability. Where Spring should be a silver bullet for your project, if that works for you. So again, both frameworks should fit building enterprise applications, but there are some advantages of using Java EE that I like more than using Spring over the years. But then, let's talk more about Jakarta EE and focus in on that. So what is Jakarta EE exactly? I will tell you all about that. And then I will tell you something about vendors and portability with Jakarta EE, a few deployment types that provide you some flexibility in the framework for deployment, how you can develop efficiently within on your local machine, and of course, how MicroProfile fits into all this. And when you have built your application, you would, of course, want to ship it to another environment like test or production. And that is where Docker comes in. And why Docker is such an important component here, I will tell you, of course, all about later in this talk. But first, Jakarta EE. How did it came to be? To understand what it really is, again, let's get back into history a little bit, to September 2017. At that time, Oracle announced the release of Java EE version 8. The long-anticipated release after Java EE 7. It was more of a quality of life release, but a release nonetheless. And the community was really waiting for a new release from Java EE because we evolved into cloud scalable environments, and we were developing Java EE for also fitting these environments. But then Oracle also announced that they were going to release the stewardship of the Java EE framework, that they were moving it over to the open source community at the Eclipse Foundation in order to make it an open source project so that it can develop faster and evolve faster with an open source community and not within Oracle. So that happened. Of course, the migration of the code from Java EE started already to Eclipse, but Oracle didn't release the brand Java EE and the logo. So the community and Eclipse had to find a new logo and name for the framework. And soon after, the name Jakarta was donated from adopted from the Apache Foundation, and a contest was set out to design a new logo for the framework, which is the colorful sailing boat that you see here. And so the brand Jakarta EE was born. And in the meantime, several very dedicated people were moving the code from Oracle to Eclipse. This was a huge effort because the code at Oracle had to be legally released, cleaned up, and then moved over. And at Eclipse, the code had to be legally accepted, put into a project in Eclipse's project structures, and roll into the build pipelines. So they had to do that for some 50-ish projects. And there was one goal that was always to be maintained during the migration, and that is 100% compatibility with Java EE 8. The first release of Jakarta EE should and is still having a goal of maintaining 100% compatibility on the specification level. And how that roadmap looks, you can see here. At 29th of January this year, the code was moved over, and from Eclipse, you could now build the Eclipse GlassFish 5.1 application server. It's a counterpart from the application server that was the same at Oracle, only then in Oracle's version control system. And the Eclipse and the community were now roadmapping the evolution of Jakarta EE, where first all the code and documents had to be rebranded with the Jakarta EE brand. That is what is happening now. We will probably see a new release of GlassFish for that. And after the first release of Jakarta EE 8, we can really start evolving the framework to Jakarta EE 9 or further, changing specifications, adding specifications, or do whatever is necessary to make the framework great again. But until now, this is all rebranding, right? There's no change yet. So what does Eclipse have in store or in mind for evolving the framework? Well, if you compare Eclipse's ideas to how it went under Oracle stewardship, there was a specification first approach. A specification was designed by Oracle and the strategic partners and led by a specification lead. The documents and TCKs were closed source. Everything was internal. And when the specification was done, one reference implementation was built to prove that the specification was working and functioning as expected. But as we might know, that was a very slow process, and therefore Eclipse wants to make it a faster process. And therefore, the vision is that Eclipse is not going to define new specifications for Jakarta EE. They expect the community to come up with ideas for solving demands that we see in building enterprise applications, good ideas that can be written in code. And when that good idea is gaining traction in the community, a specification can be extracted from it. So that should prove that we have a new specification in the framework that really provides value. And since it's open source, everybody can support this and collaborate in this. It's not an internal party. It's for everyone to see, everyone to use, everyone to adjust the documents. There's compatibility kits. Compatibility kits are also open source. And there are even more compatible implementations. Actually, we are expecting more compatible implementations from the specification that are going to be generated, so that you are not tied to one reference implementation. So if you think Jakarta E is a rebranding of Java E, that is correct. But there is a mission to Jakarta that actually should evolve the framework further. And we'll see how that turns out in the near future, of course. Okay, then let's focus at actually building services with Jakarta E and MicroProfile. Here you have three options nowadays. You can still use the old and trusted concept of an application server. You also can build your applications as Uber or Fed jars, and you have also the option of using Holo jars. And I will elaborate on all of these three options, but first start with our concept of the application server. Because perceptions might be that the application server concept is old and could not be applicable anymore today because of microservices ideas. But that's not necessarily true because, of course, microservices don't define the implementation. So how does that work? Well, your application server, you must know, is a machine that is tuned to handle as many requests as possible for you on a single runtime and be as efficient as possible with its resources. So if an application server is built properly, which is obligated by the vendors, then it should be a very powerful machine for you to use as a developer. So how does an application server work again? Let's revisit the concept and see what we can gain. So you take one Jakarta EE or Jakarta Java EE 8 compliant application server. Often you can download it as a zip file and extract it, and then you can get a whole bunch of Java libraries and configuration files, which together make up your application server. And that's it. You don't have to install anything or put keys or files anywhere. This is the whole thing. What you see is what you get. And this application server, all these configuration files, provide you the knobs and buttons that you can tweak, use to tweak your application server to your situation. And your application server is thoroughly tested by a vendor because it should be as stable, as fast, as performant, and efficient with its resources as possible, because otherwise you're not going to use it right. And another benefit from application servers I had in the past is that if you get a patch or upgraded version, you can you often get a few files that you have to replace. And that is patching your application server. You don't even have to rebuild your applications that are running on it. So looking at maintenance, that can sometimes be very beneficial. And of course, because it's an application server implementing Jakarta E specifications, it enables portability for enterprise applications. If you want to try out how a certain application server performs or handles, you can build an app and try it on different application servers as long as it's compiled against the specifications. So if you are going to build an application that will run on an application server and you use Maven, then you often build an artifact that is a web archive or an enterprise archive. And the latter contains one or more web archives. So if you use Maven to start building an enterprise application with Jakarta E, you only need one single dependency to have access to all of these specifications. This is very beneficial for you because you don't have to right-size your application here. You don't have to go look for the components you need. Everything is immediately available to you, and everything that you don't need is not put into account when you're building your VAR or EAR. So that leads ideally to very small applications that only contain your business logic, because the application server implements all the dependencies and implementations. And this can even result in web archives just a few kilobytes or megabytes in size. So I remember myself emailing an application once when the situation desired it. So you can even ship your application by email if you want to, which can't be done if you would include the 100s of megabytes application server in it. Well, this also runs on a specific version of Java, which is supported by the application server and, of course, application that runs on it. And this is a very important choice, and I will elaborate on that later because there is much more to it than it may seem. And if you're developing locally with an application server and you build a web archive, for example, as in this example, you can develop, build, and immediately build and deploy, redeploy your application on an application server. Because the build should only take milliseconds or seconds, because the applications are so small and the application servers are so fast, you can easily validate your changes without having to wait too long. And this should not only keep you focused, but for you as a developer and maybe of your teams, they should save a lot of development time with this approach. And if you talk about implementations for application servers, you have many options available for vendors that implement Java EE or Jakarta EE specifications. I have shown a few examples here. There are many more available, but I've just shown the ones I have most experience with. But what's important to remember is that the application server is provided by a vendor. And a vendor knows your application server best. So if there's maybe something wrong with it, there's a bug or an issue, your vendor should be the one to fix it, right? But some application servers only have a community edition available. Free for you to use, free for you to put in production. But if there's something wrong with it, it's hard or maybe unlikely even to get proper support for it. So you're on your own then. Other vendors like Payara have their Payara application server available as a community edition, but you also can get a support contract which allows you to file issues or questions, and they will immediately respond to it and even build a patch for you that you can apply without having to depend on the community edition and the community to fix it for you. Other vendors like Red Hat have their Wildfly application server available as a community edition. But if you get a support contract, you will be provided with, in this example, JBoss application server. And this is essentially the community edition, but with maybe some tweaks or commercial features provided by Red Hat in addition to the community edition. So when you are choosing an application server, you should consider options on support, of course, but also features that are provided by the vendor, because this can be in addition to implementing the Java EE or Jakarta EE specifications. But until now, I have talked mostly about how we do it for years now, building monoliths. It is, if you are familiar with this concept, it may, of course, sound familiar to you, but where do microservices come in then? How do you build microservices within the Java EE or Jakarta EE ecosystem? Like I said, the perception is that you can't build microservices with Jakarta EE because of the old concept of application servers. So why do I think that is not necessarily true? Okay, then let's first look at how MicroProfile works, because that framework is built next to Java EE in 2017, and now Jakarta EE, as a solution for building microservices within the Java EE ecosystem. Because in 2016, a group of developers saw the slow evolution of Java EE as a problem for building microservices, and they decided to look at Java EE 7, the site specifications that they could reuse or borrow for building microservices. This was CDI, JSONP, and JAX-RS. And then they released MicroProfile with these specifications. It was version 1.0. And after this version, they started adding new specifications that solved demands in building microservices, like health checks and metrics for your orchestrators, your scalable environment, fault tolerance, tracing, REST client and JWT for microservice inter-service communication, and config as a specification that was not only handy for MicroProfile, but also highly desired in Jakarta EE. So with this framework, you can build microservices. And if you are used to Spring Boot, this might also sound as look very familiar to you. So how do you build a MicroProfile microservice then? Well, like with Jakarta EE, you only need one dependency for a specific MicroProfile version that you want to use. And of course, when there's an implementation for it in your Maven project. Again, you have the full specification set available here, and what you don't use is not taken into account. So if you build a microservice like this, an artifact will be generated. And it, instead of a web archive or a enterprise archive, it's likely that you now build a jar, Java archive, which will become an Uber jar. When you develop code, it's of course compiled and put into the jar. Next to the implementation of your choice, for example, Thorntail, that implements the version of MicroProfile. So the application server and your code are now one artifact. Again, this runs on a specific version of Java that is supported. But what you have now is one single artifact that contains your code and application server so that you don't have to ship these two separately. Uber or fat jars can be considered fat and big in size, but they're only containing everything essential to run as an application server with your code. And because it should run in a scalable environment, you're unlikely to log in on these servers. So there's no or little operational management tools available to manage the running jars. If a jar is not running healthy, which can be checked with the MicroProfile health check endpoint, then your service is likely to be shut down by the orchestrator and started up again in a new instance. This is how microservices work. So like I said, it's the opposite of lean and tidy, bigger in size. It gets harder to email your application, like compared to the small web archive. But this is not how you build microservices with Jakarta EE, right? I just talked about MicroProfile. So how do you then build microservices with Jakarta EE? Well, that's easy. You can easily mix them up because you have now two specification sets that where MicroProfile really extends the Jakarta EE framework. So that opens possibilities for building a Jakarta EE compliant application server for microservices. These application servers implement both Jakarta EE and the MicroProfile specifications. So in your project, you now not only add your dependency for Jakarta EE, but also the one for MicroProfile. So this allows you to seamlessly use both specification sets in one project, in one server. So now you can, for example, use JMS in your health checks, for example, if that makes sense for your project. So there is no boundary anymore. It's just one thing now. And then you can ask me maybe, okay, good, but do I need some kind of exotic application server for this because you didn't show that before? That is not really true because I have already shown two of them. Many application servers nowadays already support both Jakarta EE and MicroProfile. So if you ever want to see these frameworks together, the application server is the right place to look. So now we have covered the application server and the Uber jar. Then the last variant that you have is the Holo jar. Let's say we again take the microprofile and Jakarta EE together as a point, a goal. And then we build now a WAR with it. Not a jar, not a runnable jar. It will just be a WAR that contains our business logic. And now we are going to use a HoloJar runtime, like, for example, Payara Micro. This jar contains a whole application server that runs MicroProfile and Jakarta EE applications. But since it runs as a microservice with a specific version of Java, of course, it's kind of different from using an application server. Because you can run this jar essentially with Java, and as a parameter, you point to the web archive that you want to run on this server. So you can now ship your application server as one artifact instead of a bunch of files, and still build and ship your web archive separately. So it's not put together as a Uber jar. Again, since the application server must run as a microservice that you are unlikely to access during runtime, it has little to no operational management tools in it, which makes it a lot less smaller than the probably equivalent application server that it comes from. So this approach might suit your situation in a project when you are building microservices. But when you have built your service, of course, you want to ship it to another environment using Docker, because Docker is a very efficient tool in shipping and running application servers. But Docker also obscures what's running inside, and that is essentially a very big benefit for using Jakarta EE. So how does that work? Let's say we are using Docker then and choosing a base image of our choosing. Of course, we want to have Java run on that because we want to run a Java application. Choose our deployment type of choosing, so the application server, the Uber jar or the Holo jar. And of course, our application is put as well into it. So together, this Docker image can create containers, and these containers will run your application server with your application. So for local development, this is handy because you can use Docker Compose to spin up your application as part of the rest of your local environment. But the Docker is also to ship this single image anywhere and run it anywhere. You can build locally your image that you're actually going to use on production, for example. So if you then add your production environment, you place your Docker image there, so to start containers from it. And using an orchestrator, you can actually run your application as a microservice. And here is where it all comes together. Here, the orchestrator can use the microprofile health check endpoint and metrics for determining how the services are running, if they're healthy and if they're not too overloaded. And inside is your running your application server that is, if done properly, handling as many requests as possible. But this is not exposed to the external world. So in this instance, it doesn't even matter if it's Jakarta EE or anything running inside the Docker image. It's just exposing HTTP endpoints, doing database stuff, maybe messaging, but in a way as efficient as possible. And because microprofile is added, it feels like a microservice. But that's not all. I already said we have to take Java into account when we are building Jakarta EE as well. So why is that? Many of us might think that Java has a default like Oracle JDK and the Hotspot JVM. Well, this might be true. It's a perfect choice for building and probably running your Java applications and even your application servers. But nowadays, you also have the OpenJDK available as the root open source project for Java. But there are more forks from it. Even Amazon has their own JDK fork, as well as Azul Systems that provide the Zulu JDK. And why should you bother? Because is Hotspot not a viable JVM to run your application server? Of course it is, but you also have the option of opting, choosing the OpenJ9 JVM, for example. And doing this can have a benefit of comparing how efficiently or stable your application server will run with any of these JVMs. But more importantly, your application server vendor can demand or require that you use a specific JDK and JVM for running your application server to get enhanced support or even required for support. So if you are using an application server from whichever vendor, you are wise to check which JDK is recommended or required to build and run it. Then, wrapping this all up, can you build microservices with your Carta EE and MicroProfile in 2019? As I have shown you, yes, you can. It's probably it's perfectly fine to do so. But Jakarta EE feels like more of a monolithic approach than really fitting microservices. And there's an angle of approach where Jakarta EE is at its best, because in some instances, do you even really need microservices? Microservices architectures also probably come with some very high operational and infrastructural overhead that you don't have when running a single monolith. So when you are using Jakarta EE, it's wise to start with a monolith that is scalable. And because Java EE is feature rich and MicroProfile allows it to run in scalable environments, you can run it as a scalable monolith, which might be enough, or split it up further into microservices when the situation requires it. And this is a vision that's apparently also shared by Steve Millage, which is the founder of Payara, and he calls this the majestic monolith. So there, Jakarta EE really has a place in our current landscape of building enterprise applications. And with a future on cloud-native Java, we should evolve this framework to adopt any demand we have for this framework running in such environments. So well then, this was my talk. Thank you all for listening. I hope you have learned anything. And if there are any questions, I will certainly be happy to answer them.
Thanks, Edwin. So let's just now open it up and see if there are any questions. I'll quickly check the, okay. So from Sergey here is, does Wildfly support MicroProfile?
Yes.
Yeah, so that's the easy one. Then let's see. Yes, but not all full MicroProfile specs. Okay, so exact implementation, I think my recommendation is for everyone to go to the microprofile.io site and check it out there.
Yes.
Okay, Sergey is thanking for the answer, still waiting for the open API support. I'm not sure what exactly this refers to. So Sergey, if you wanna clarify, or if someone else can help me out with this one, that would be great. But in the meanwhile, while we're still waiting for additional questions, just a quick observation from my end. This is literally globe or worldwide related and vibrant community. We have people from, you know, from all around the globe, from Nigeria to Taiwan, Japan, Germany, anywhere, and that is fantastic to see. I'm sure this is nothing new, but it's nice to see messages and hellos from all around the world.
Yes, very nice.
Okay.
I think I can answer the question about the Open API to support.
Yes, go
I
ahead.
have to, at least Open API is a specification that is available in MicroProfile, but not yet in Jakarta EE. So if you
Oh, this was just a question. Sorry, I see now
okay.
clarification. OpenAI in Wildfly. But you go ahead with your explanation. I think it will be beneficial to everyone. So go ahead. Sorry, Edwin.
No problem. Open API is a specification that is available in MicroProfile. So Wildfly implements both MicroProfile and Java EE at Jakarta EE later. So you should be able to access the Open API endpoints in Wildfly out of the box.
Okay, so we have one potentially tricky question here. So, what should I use, Spring Boot or Jakarta EE? So, if you ask me, I probably will not have the most politically correct answer, but I will let admin potentially answer that question.
Yeah, it might be a little bit. It depends. Like I have shown, Jakarta EE and MicroProfile can build services similar to Spring Boot. So, if there's really a reason for you to use Spring Boot because of a specific feature or maybe some even bleeding edge feature, or you have a culture around you that is really Spring-minded, or you have a support contract somewhere that dictates it, all these parameters can define using Spring Boot or Java EE. So there is no really, even Spring Boot is no silver bullet for building microservices, just as no other framework is. But there are several parameters that you can evaluate and not just looking at, oh, I can download Spring Boot and it runs very fast and I can build a service with it in 5 minutes. For a production service and at a customer, you're not done right at that moment. You really need to build an application on it that makes money probably in production, that runs stable and serves certain clients. So you have to evaluate requirements for your project to evaluate if Spring Boot or whatever framework is a sufficient solution for that.
Okay, and then we have another question here. I heard there will be some problems with JavaX namespace. How that will affect the micro profile? So for the time being, JavaX namespace will stay as it is for the Jakarta EE8 release. But going forward, yes, you probably are all aware that there are some restrictions on Java trademark usage from the Jakarta EE perspective. And that topic has been and is still being discussed in the community. We are probably going to switch to Jakarta namespace. But this is a post Jakarta EE8, and it is still being discussed. How and will this impact or have any impact on MicroProfile? That is really to be seen by both of the communities, so Jakarta EE8 and MicroProfile, and discussion is ongoing.
Yes, correct. Does that answer the question, or can I elaborate further?
Oh yeah, but please feel free to elaborate further, Edwin. Yes.
Yeah, so the situation is right now, there's either a Big Bang approach or a incremental approach of adjusting all the specifications with the JavaX namespace to Jakarta. When we do that, of course, we will break backwards compatibility. And we are always trying to prevent that. So we are now in a situation of, are we going Big Bang or are we going incremental for only the specification that we're actually touching? Or are we going in one of these directions with adding maybe profiles for legacy support, like we have now the web and the full profile for Java EE and Jakarta EE, but might we also maybe think of a legacy profile or something in between? We are not out of the discussions yet, but we are trying to make the transition to Jakarta E and further versions of it as painless as possible, of course.
So there are some interesting questions that are kind of a little bit out of scope here, I would say. Carlos Santos has questions with regards migrating Oracle SOA Suite bus to microservices, and if anyone had any experience with that. So if there are some experiences, please get in touch with Carlos Santos. Martin Stefanko is stating here that JAVOX namespace, it's pretty much what I believe we have communicated. So JAVOX namespace at this point does not have any impact on MicroProfile. It is completely different namespace, you know, or .eclipse.microprofile. If there is going to be any impact there, it is certainly up to MicroProfile community to make decisions on that, or slash Jakarta E community. So no impact at this point.
Yes.
Okay. Anything else, or we can close this call, and then I will, you know, as soon as we give or set the dates, and I believe there is a date end of August, but we're trying to see if there is going to be any additional Jakarta Tech Talk mid-August, and I will make sure I will communicate that with you as soon as possible. It is a vacation time, so we're a little bit, restricted from that perspective in terms of the communication, but don't worry, there are many talks to come, and please look at the calendar and get in touch with us if any questions with regards to Tech Talks. At this point, I would like to thank Edwin very, very much. Many thanks from the chat as well to you, Edwin. And we will all be in touch.
All right. See you next time.
Okay. Till next time. See you all later. Okay. Bye now.
Bye.